See. All right. I think I'm live. Let's see. Do do do. Gonna check. Let's make sure. Anybody on there? Let's see. Do I see how many people? I don't even know how many people are on here. Maybe not. Okay. All right. Apparently we're good. All right. So, hi everybody. My name is Christopher DiPiazza. Sorry, I said I was going to start at 4 and we're starting at like 4:12. And the reason for that is because my ceiling started leaking at 3:59. So I had to put a bowl under that and call the landlord as soon as I'm done with you guys. And hi, Lyndon. I'll see you soon, hopefully in the summertime. But anyway, I was asked by Field Station Dinosaurs to do a little art demo for you guys since everybody's at home. So this is something that you guys can do at home to start to help pass the time, and maybe we'll learn a little bit too. I'm not just gonna talk about the art, I'm gonna talk about the dinosaur itself too. And that dinosaur is going to be Tyrannosaurus Rex, because that's everybody's, well, not everybody's favorite, but everybody knows Tyrannosaurus Rex. I'm personally a plant-eating dinosaur kind of guy. I like Triceratops the best, but T-Rex everybody knows. And let's see if we this does really well. Maybe we'll do some more, and maybe we'll start taking requests for different kinds of dinosaurs. So I'm gonna draw this dinosaur, and you guys can draw your own version of that as we go along. And it should take maybe about an hour. I said an hour. It might take longer, might take shorter. We'll see. All right, cool. So we're going to be working on here. And if you type questions into the chat thing, I will do my best to acknowledge them. But there's a lot of people on here. There's 35 people on here, apparently. So that's cool. so if I miss it, don't get offended. Just because I didn't see it. All right, cool. So we're gonna do T-Rex. So I'm gonna do actually, we're gonna see if we can maybe do two T-Rexes, because T-Rex looked different as it aged. We know that younger T-Rexes are very different looking from bigger T-Rexes. So much so that a lot of paleontologists thought that what we now believe is a juvenile Tyrannosaurus used to be a completely different species. Now we know they're the same. They're both Tyrannosaurus. So we're gonna start with the big one, the adult. So I'm going to angle this here, and I'm going to show you guys as I go along in more detail. I'm going to hold up to the camera, but hopefully you guys can see what I'm doing here. So let's see. Let's start with the head. I always start with the head of everything I do. Tyrannosaurus's head. And I'm going to do this in kind of like a 45-degree angle, so it's going to sort of be looking at us. It's not going to be a complete side view. A lot of people do dinosaurs in side view. I do that too, but I like doing 45 degrees as well. So I don't know if you guys can see that. That's a very, very light sketch of what's going to be our T-Rex's head. It's almost box-like, almost rectangular, but I rounded out a little bit. And I'm going to accentuate certain parts of it, and I'll show you as we go along. I'm going to start with the eye. Tyrannosaurus Rex had what we call binocular vision. And that means that both of its eye sockets were facing in the same direction forward, so it could actually see how far away something was. And that doesn't sound like a big deal to us because we have binocular vision too. Humans and actually all primates, because humans are primates. Have binocular vision as well. But not all animals do. A lot of animals don't. Horses don't, deer don't. Their eyes are facing the sides. But our eyes face forward so we can see depth. We can tell how far away something is. And the reason why humans have binocular vision is because our ancestors, which were probably something similar to a monkey at some point, were living up in the trees And if you're swinging around in the trees, you need to know how far away a branch is before you grab it. So it's important to know how far away something is. In the case of Tyrannosaurus rex and a lot of other meat-eating animals like cats and wolves and things that also have binocular vision, if they're chasing things or hunting things, they want to know how far away something is when they're going after it. So Tyrannosaurus rex definitely have binocular vision. So that whole thing, if you've ever seen Jurassic Park, they always say, oh, if the T-Rex looks at you, don't move, then it won't see you. That's not true. It could totally see that you're there. You just became like food that's not running away. Anyway, so I'm gonna draw the eyes there, and then around the eyes, I'm gonna do some like bony ridges. The Tyrannosaurus rex, the texture of the skull on this animal, on the top of the nose and around the eyes, had a very specific kind of bone that tells us that this dinosaur in life probably had some kind of bony protrusions on there. So it didn't really quite have horns per se, but it probably had some kind of a bony, tough texture on the top of its head. And we don't know why it had that. It might have had it for like display, just to look neat, to intimidate other tyrannosaurs. Maybe they used them as a weapon when they were fighting other Tyrannosaurus rex. A lot of dinosaurs, dinosaurs like birds, but a lot of animals today use like horns and stuff to push each other around. Baryonyx. Yeah, we could do baryonyx one day. We'll talk about it. But yeah, baryonyx sounds cool. But anyway, someone just requested baryonyx, which is a neat dinosaur, very different. So there's the eyes for our T-Rex. And there's the bony ridge. See, I kind of did like some bony, blocky things around the eyes there. And you can see I did a little bit of the ridge from the other side, on the other side of the head, because this dinosaur is not from the side. It's kind of turning its head a little bit to look at you. So I put a little bit of the other bony ridge in frame so you could tell it's not a purely side view. I'm gonna do this T-Rex with its mouth open. I accidentally started to do it with its mouth closed, but I decided I'm gonna do it with mouth open. So let's do the upper lip, and I'm gonna do some like little kind of like breaking it up. You can see I'm doing like little lines there. Looks like he has really chapped lips. In real life, we know thanks to the texture of the skull around the teeth that on its face it had kind of really rough, scaly texture, kind of similar to that of an alligator or crocodiles around the mouth. So maybe it had some kind of a soft tissue covering part of the teeth. Not really like lips like we have, or like, it couldn't like kiss or anything, but maybe some kind of soft tissue like a lizard has. If you think about a lizard or a snake, when their mouth is closed, you can't see their teeth. There's a lot of scientists who think that that wasn't the case of T-Rex. A lot of scientists think that T-Rex's teeth were always showing as well, even when the mouth was closed. And that's a totally valid hypothesis, and there is evidence to back that up. But this is one of those cases where, like, we don't actually know. There's evidence that supports this idea as well. So I'm just going to do it this way. But if you want to make yours toothier looking, that's fine with me. That's up to you. The great thing about paleo art is there's different ways to draw the same thing, and it's all correct. So I started to draw the lower jaw, so you could see his mouth is, or her mouth, it could be a girl too. The mouth is open, and we're gonna start doing some teeth. So T-Rex teeth were really cool. They were different in the front. So in the front, they're actually quite narrow, and then as you went to the side, they got longer and thicker. And the biggest of these teeth were actually literally the size and somewhat the shape of a banana. Now again, these teeth are partially covered by soft tissue, so I'm not going to make them all the way sticking out. And also, a lot of people don't realize this. When you look at the picture of a T-Rex skull, or if you see a T-Rex skull at a museum, what a lot of people don't realize is the teeth when the dinosaur, after it dies, all the gums and stuff, the soft stuff that connects the teeth to the rest of the skull, that rots away over time. And the teeth, between the time that the dinosaur dies and the time that paleontologists find it, the teeth sometimes fall out of their sockets a little bit. There's a famous T-Rex skull. Its nickname is Stan. And Stan's on display in a lot of different museums. In New Jersey, they have, I believe, there's a cast of Stan's skull at the New Jersey State Museum. Okay. And if you look at Stan's skull, the teeth are really, really long, but in life they actually wouldn't have been sticking out that much because they've partially fallen out of their sockets. But they were still nevertheless very big teeth. So I'm going to do the teeth on the other side here. And also, if you notice, the teeth are facing, they're kind of curved. They're not straight and pointy. Someone mentioned Baryonyx before. Baryonyx is an example of a dinosaur that had straight, pointy teeth. T-Rex did not. T-Rex's teeth were kind of curved. I actually have a chunk of a cast of a T-Rex tooth here. Uh-oh, T-Rex died again. Here's a cast of a T-Rex tooth, and this is just a tip of one. It actually would have been quite a bit longer, but you can see that it's curved, so it curves backwards. So the tip of the nose would have been out here, the back of the mouth would have been here, and that's because when T-Rex bit something, typically something that if it was still alive, didn't want to get eaten, it holds the food in the mouth. If the teeth were pointier or faced a different direction, it would be easier for the prey to escape. Or if he was just grabbing chunks of meat to eat, it's easier to swallow because T-Rex didn't chew. Okay, so it's easier for it to just swallow big chunks, force everything towards the back of the mouth if the teeth are curved. And young Tyrannosaurus Rex also had curved teeth. So I have a real tooth. This is not a cast of a young one. So this is a little guy, okay? And but you can still tell that the tooth is curved. And also, I don't know if you can tell here, but there's like a definite yeah, you could see. There's an edge here. And in life there would have been serrations. So Tyrannosaurus Rex teeth weren't just simply pointy, they were also serrated on the sides, kind of like a steak knife, if you ever use a steak knife to cut meat, and that helps the dinosaur cut its food as it was eating it. So it was kind of like having all the silverware built into its face, which makes sense because Tyrannosaurus Rex didn't really have big long arms and claws. So it did everything with its mouth. A lot of dinosaurs actually had serrated teeth. A lot of meat-eating dinosaurs, the dromaeosaurs, the raptors had serrated teeth as well. Okay, now if you look at the back of this Tyrannosaurus's mouth, this section right here is very, very thick. It's very blocky and very big. It almost looks like the Tyrannosaurus Rex has like chubby cheeks. But Tyrannosaurus Rex would have had a big block of muscle. The skull has a section there, and also a section up here where huge blocks of muscle would have attached, which means that this dinosaur had a huge, not huge, I say huge a lot, a very powerful bite force. Tyrannosaurus Rex's bite was definitely much stronger than any animal that we can measure today, and it needed to be because the way it hunted animals that had armor like Triceratops or maybe even Ankylosaurus, and also the way it ate. We know Tyrannosaurus Rex was eating bones as well as meat because we found poop, fossilized poop from T-Rex, and there's chunks of bone in there. So Tyrannosaurus Rex may have eaten similarly to like a modern hyena with really powerful jaws, and it not only ate the meat, but it also ate the bones as well. And on the top of the head, like the base of the neck, I'm making this very tall as well. A lot of people make the mistake. I'm gonna do a bad thing. A lot of people make a mistake and make their T-Rex's head like start there and they just keep going down. That's wrong. Tyrannosaurus Rex had a lot of muscle up here too, so it actually would have had like a little hump on the top of its head. Jurassic Park and Jurassic World, as cool as their dinosaurs look, they are guilty of not giving their Tyrannosaurus Rex enough meat up here. There's that famous poster for the latest Jurassic World movie. And in the poster, there's like, it's from that scene, if you've ever seen that movie, where they're on the island and all the dinosaurs are running away and the volcano's exploding. And then Chris Pratt gets attacked by a Carnotaurus. And then the last minute, Tyrannosaurus Rex comes in and saves the day. And it squishes the Carnotaurus and then it dramatically roars at the sky. And that's on like all the posters for this movie. Well, that poster drives me crazy because the T-Rex has this little skinny little neck and it wouldn't have been able to have any bite force in real life. So make sure to give your Tyrannosaurus Rex extra muscle. And that's kind of funny to me because Jurassic Park and Jurassic World, that franchise, is guilty of like making their dinosaurs less than accurate. But a lot of times they do it to like be more exciting. This is a case where they actually made the dinosaur look less realistic and less cool. Like that big hump on the neck implies how powerful it is, and they didn't do that. But anyway, so here's T-Rex's neck. It would have had a really big, thick neck. Tyrannosaurus would have had to sustain a lot of impact. We have evidence that Tyrannosaurus actually was charging into other dinosaurs with its mouth open and sustained really powerful impacts to the point where we actually have vertebrae from the neck that are broken and then healed, which means that the dinosaur didn't die when it broke the neck. It actually got an injury in part of the neck and then survived and then kept hunting, which is pretty crazy. So it's going to have a nice thick neck. And now I'm going to start doing the body. The torso of Tyrannosaurus Rex was very wide, much wider than most other theropods. A lot of toys and pictures of Tyrannosaurus Rex, they depict it with too thin of a body. Tyrannosaurus Rex literally was what we would call barrel chested. Its torso was like a big barrel. And the arms actually would have been pretty far apart. So the arms are relatively small, but don't be fooled. They're actually still quite powerful, as powerful, if not stronger, than the strongest human arms. So I would not scoff at Tyrannosaurus's arms just because they're proportionally small. They're still very powerful. No one really knows what they use those arms for, though. It's kind of a mystery. Some people think that they were completely useless, but they did have a lot of muscle attachments there, so they were probably being used for something. Some people say that they could have used them to pick up things, maybe if they wanted to carry food, or maybe if they carried their babies that way. We don't know. But they were probably using them for something. And a lot of Tyrannosaurus' relatives also had short arms with two fingers on each hand. So, and those relatives lived millions of years earlier. So, like things like Gorgosaurus or Albertosaurus, there's a lot of other Tyrannosaurs out there that had the same thing going on, and they lived millions of years before. So, this is like an evolutionary trend that just kept persisting. So, it wasn't useless. We just don't know quite what it was for. So in the body, there the hips would have been right here, and there's a big bone from the hips called the pubis that comes all the way. I'll show you. That would have come all the way down here. It would have been shaped like a boot, and you can see these on skeletons. So I'm going to make sure I accommodate that. A lot of people make the midsection too high up. No, it would have been much deeper. And there's actually, believe it or not, everyone knows about the ribs that come down here, but there's actually a set of ribs that existed underneath called belly ribs or gastralia, and a lot of dinosaurs had those. So you got to account for those as well. So a lot of times, popular artwork of Tyrannosaurus, it looks a lot thinner or skinnier than it really should have been in real life. I remember I posted a Tyrannosaurus Rex drawing that I did, and someone asked, "Oh, it looks so fat," but actually, that's just the way that they were. They weren't really fat. Someone asked a question and I missed it. What is this question? Let's see. Oh, it's about being entered into the drawing. Oh yeah, so if you submit your artwork that you do along here, there's a chance that you could win some tickets to Field Station Dinosaurs in Leonia, New Jersey. And I will be there. I've already went this past summer and I drew some dinosaurs for everybody, but I will be there again this summer on July 11th. So if you want to go then, I'll see you there. Let's see. Lyndon has a question. She wants to know, do T-Rex's arms go north to south or east to west, like a clap? Oh, I know what you're talking about. That's a good question. Oh, yeah, I forgot about that question. So, another thing is a lot of people, when if you ask someone to do their best dinosaur impression, they take their arms and they go like this, this little pose. Here's, look, see, now I'm a T-Rex, two fingers. Now I'm Allosaurus with three fingers. Okay, this is wrong. This is not good. This is bad. Okay, no dinosaur. Okay, even the ones that walked on all fours, a lot of them didn't do this with their hands. They did this. Okay, the toy that I have here, this is from the company Batat. You can see here, this is correct. This dinosaur's hands are correct. He looks like he's clapping, like he's playing the cymbals. Okay. A lot of toys get this wrong. Jurassic Park gets this wrong all the time. Okay, so remember, dinosaurs, especially the two-legged ones, were doing this. They could not physically do this. The bones wouldn't work this way. A lot of people say, "Oh, why can't they just move their hands?" They can't move their hands. We're special. We're very fortunate. We are able. We have bones in our wrists that allow us to rotate our hands around like this. Dinosaurs didn't have those, so they physically could not do this. Okay, unless they broke their wrists. So they were actually stuck like this. Believe it or not, a lot of animals have this. Modern birds, which are dinosaurs, also do this. Think about a chicken wing, okay? Next time you have, get chicken wings, okay? The wing is like this. The tip part is like this, which would be the hand, and there's the forearm, okay? You're never gonna see a chicken go like that. They can rotate their whole wing to the side. That's doable. But they're never gonna be able to rotate just the tip part. That's not happening, okay? And the same would have been for dinosaurs. So, good question. So anyway, let's go back to our picture here. So I have our big torso from our T-Rex. Now I'm gonna do the legs. Don't be afraid to make the T-Rex's legs really big and thick, okay? Because it needs to have really big, powerful, muscular legs in order to keep that big body up. So here's the calf, and here's the ankle, here's the heel, here's the foot. There's the foot there. It's kind of look like a tree trunk. And then I'm gonna start doing the toes. One toe, two toe, three toe. Okay, now if you look, I make my toes kind of rounded. They're not that sharp. A lot of people make the mistake of the toe claws and their dinosaurs making them all sharp, with the exception of like raptors, because they held their claws up. But most dinosaurs wouldn't have had very sharp toe claws simply because they were walking on them all the time. And the toes were getting worn out. Okay, if they were scraping against the dirt and the rocks all the time, there's no reason why they would be that sharp. Velociraptor and its relatives were different. They held that one toe claw up so they would stay sharp. But most dinosaurs couldn't do that. And then I'm gonna do the other leg. It's gonna be here. He's gonna have his knees are going to be bent, so one leg is going to be up, and this foot is going to be kind of like he's running. He's like mid run, mid stride, or something like that. All right, so there's the knee, there's the calf, and note how I'm not afraid to be messy here. I'm not like making a bunch of clean lines. Okay, this is, I want to make sure I get everything right, and sometimes that requires a little trial and error. Okay, very few artists, none that I know of. Okay, just like do everything perfect the first time. They don't. It's not a thing. Okay, so that foot is kind of being lifted up in the air. And then the tail, another mistake people make is a lot of people, their instinct would be to draw the back of the thigh, like it's coming up here, like I have there. That's not happening. Okay, so we're gonna actually erase that line. Okay, because there is actually a huge muscle that attached the thigh to the rest of the tail. So that line would not have been very defined. And the base of the tail on Tyrannosaurus would have been very thick. And it would have tapered down. I'm going to kind of curve the tail around a little bit so it fits in the page. Okay. And there we have it. This is like the basic drawing. We still have a lot more to do. But here it is. It's not perfect. I can already tell there's some things here that I don't like about it, proportion-wise. But that's okay. We're just having fun. So now I'm going to work on to a couple more details. Okay, so we're going to go into some nitty-gritty stuff. So the first thing I'm going to do that I realized I didn't do the first time is the ear. Dinosaurs had ears just like we did. They didn't really look like our ears, but they did. So I'm going to draw like a little hole here, a little like little fold of skin behind the hole. So now our Tyrannosaurus can hear. And let's see, what else am I going to do? I'm going to draw some extra lines on the neck here to kind of make it look nice and wrinkly and folded. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to start shading the inside of the mouth. There would have been a tongue in there, so I'll draw a tongue. And then I'm going to just use my pencil. I'm just using a regular pencil, by the way. I'm not using any fancy schmancy expensive art tools. This is like a regular old mechanical pencil that you can buy at like Staples or whatever. I've had it for years, so don't think I'm using anything crazy. So I'm just shading in the back of the mouth. I'm going to start dark in the back, and I'm going to get lighter, and I'm going to apply less pressure on my pencil as I get towards the front of the mouth. So, because in the back of the mouth, there would obviously be more shadow, and that makes it look a lot nicer, doesn't it? Almost three-dimensional. Right? Makes it look like it's a real animal that's coming at you and not just a drawing. And that's cool. That's what we're going for. I'm going to do a couple, a little bit more shading here, maybe under the eye.
on that big bony ridge. Some shading there. And this is just practice. People sometimes ask me, "Oh, how'd you learn to be such a good artist or such a good drawer?" Well, first of all, I'm not that good. I have a lot of practice. It's a lot of hard work, a lot of practice, right? So the good thing is I also like to draw. It's fun for me. So practicing is fun. So when I was a kid, I would just draw all the time in my free time. So you can do that too. If you want to get better and you want to learn how to do better art of anything, not just dinosaurs, just practice. That's all you have to do. There's no secret. There's no magic wand to it. Just practice. So I'm just putting in some random little lines. I'm even going to shade in the top of the teeth. Okay, so the teeth, where the tooth meets the top of the lip, I'm going to put a little bit of shading because there would be a little shadow there from the lip. There might even be more shadow. I don't even know. But this looks good. And a lot of art is that. A lot of it's like just not even like just knowing. It's more like testing something out and seeing if it looks right. A lot of times I'm doing this, I'm thinking to myself, man, would that shadow really be there? Would it not? Does that make sense logically? And I just try it out. And if it doesn't look right, then it's probably not logical. And if it does look right, then great, I'll just keep it. Do some shading under the neck. The darkest shading is going to be on the bottom, the very bottom, because that's where all the shadows gather, right? Do a little shading on the chin, the bottom of the jaw. There, cool. I'm going to shade the arm that's farthest away from us, where it meets the torso, and gradually lighten up, just like we did with the tongue. See how I did that? So it's darkest here, and it gets lighter there. Okay, and this arm. I'm going to do some a line here and some shading down there, implying that there's a little bit of a separation between the chest and what begins to be the belly. And this arm would make a shadow. So this would cast a shadow on the side of the T-Rex. And here's the trick. So since the body is curved, it's like a barrel shape, right? Okay. The shadow would also be curved. If I just drew a straight line shadow, that wouldn't look right. So I'm gonna make my shadow a little bit curved too. I see there's a question, so I'm gonna answer that in a second, as soon as I finish this shadow there. All right, let's see. Gustav's from Suffern, New York says, "Hi. We'll have to practice for a couple hours even to draw the shape like that." Oh, well, that's okay. That's fine. Just do what you can, right? I mean, people say, "Oh, wow, you do this so fast." But what you don't we don't realize is I've been doing this since I was like two, okay? And I've been drawing all the time, like nonstop. Like ask my family, it doesn't stop. Since then, so I've been drawing for like 30 years. So I have a lot of practice. So yeah, absolutely. Just draw the shape that you want to do, or draw your own version. It doesn't have to be the exact same T-Rex that I'm drawing. A lot of times, I like to just see stuff and I get inspired by it, and I draw my own version of what I think is cool. Let's go back to the top of the head here. So, T-Rex, there's some controversy about one of the ways that Tyrannosaurus Rex might have looked when it was alive, and a lot of people still can't agree on that, and that is whether or not it would have had feathers. There's a lot of controversy about that. And what's interesting is there's evidence for the feathers having been there, and then there's also evidence that it would not have had feathers. So there's two like schools of thought, and they're neither one of them is wrong. Again, like I said earlier, this is the cool thing about paleontology. You could have multiple different ideas that are both correct. We just don't know enough. So some people say that Tyrannosaurus couldn't have had feathers. And the reason why they say that is because they have actually found fossilized imprints from Tyrannosaurus's skin. So believe it or not, we don't, or not necessarily Tyrannosaurus rex, but close relatives. So I believe Tarbosaurus, which is a very close relative of T-Rex, has skin. And I think the other one is Gorgosaurus, I want to say. I could be wrong though. It's either, yeah, I think it's Gorgosaurus, which are both tyrannosaurids. They had short arms with two fingers on each hand, very close relatives of T-Rex. And they have, we actually have skin imprints from both of those guys, and we can apply that to Tyrannosaurus Rex, and that skin imprint shows up scaly. It's like bumpy little, you wouldn't have been able to pick out, like, I'm not even gonna bother drawing individual scales because they wouldn't show. Just like if you were looking at a lizard from 100 feet away, okay, you wouldn't be able to pick out all the scales on that lizard. You wouldn't notice the scales are there until you're right up close to it, maybe even with a magnifying glass. So same thing with T-Rex. You wouldn't really be able to see all these individual scales for the most part. They were very, very small. And I believe they found patches of skin from, I believe, the neck. They found patches of skin from, I want to say, the hips, the back area. And I believe they found patches of skin from underneath the tail. And all those patches of skin show up scaly and bumpy. Okay. So, based on that evidence, okay, if you're going purely off of factual, hard evidence that you can see, okay, then yeah, I guess the answer would be that Tyrannosaurus Rex is scaly and not feathery. But here's the thing. Here's where the other side comes in. That's only from those parts of the body. What about the rest of the body? Right? What about like the top of the head or the arms? And if you want to talk about relatives, here's the thing. Tyrannosaurus Rex, it also has other relatives that we found feathers on. Okay. So much so that on the dinosaur family tree of the kinds of dinosaurs that surrounded Tyrannosaurus Rex, so all the other kinds of dinosaurs that are around it, so like the dromaeosaurs, which were the raptors, and the oviraptorosaurs, and the ornithomimids like Struthiomimus and Gallimimus, and the therizinosaurs like Therizinosaurus. Okay, Tyrannosaurus Rex was like nestled in that group called the Silurosaurs. All other Silurosaurian dinosaurs we found feathers on. And we've even found feathers on a relative of Tyrannosaurus Rex called Eutyrannus. Eutyrannus was a tyrannosauroid, so it wasn't as close to T-Rex as, say, like Tarbosaurus or Gorgosaurus, but it was still pretty close. And it was big, too. A lot of people try to say, oh, the feathers can only be on small dinosaurs. No, it's not true. We have evidence of feathers on more than one different kinds of big dinosaurs. Eutyrannus was about 30 feet long, and it was covered in feathers. We actually found beautifully preserved imprints from feathers on the dinosaur. So there is an argument to say that maybe Tyrannosaurus Rex had some kind of feathers as well. Were they long feathers? Were they short? Maybe they were kind of like hair on an elephant or a rhino, where they were very, very short and you wouldn't have even noticed it unless you were right up close. A lot of people think rhinos and elephants and hippos, for instance, are hairless. They're mammals, they're not dinosaurs. But I'm just using it as an example. But they're not hairless. A rhinoceros is covered in hair. The hair is just very tiny, and you don't see it until you're close. So I'm actually going to give our T-Rex some little bit of hints of feathers, and I'm going to kind of concentrate it to the top of the animal. So I'm going to erase the back and the top of the tail and the top of the head, and I'm going to go back and I'm going to just kind of make the texture of the top of this dinosaur a little bit fuzzier looking, and I'm doing that by just drawing little tiny short lines. Connor wants to know if I can draw Parasaurolophus. Yeah, sure. In the future, not today. I don't think we'll have enough time today. But yeah, maybe if we do it again, maybe next week or something, we'll figure it out. But that's a good idea. Parasaurolophus is a cool dinosaur. But anyway, but maybe you might even be able to see on the camera. But you could see that ever so slightly, there's like little fuzz on top of that T-Rex. I'm doing it that way. If you don't want to put feathers on your T-Rex and you think it's more likely that they didn't have the feathers, that's cool. That's fine. You could do it that way too. That's also considered scientifically accurate. There are more than one ways to draw the same dinosaur correctly. That's the cool thing about paleo art. There's still certain things you gotta follow, like with the hands, right? But this is something that you can have a little bit of freedom with. I'm gonna go back to the shading. I'm gonna start shading the bottom leg. I'm gonna start dark, and I'm gonna work my way out. Let's see. There we go. Some shading on that leg. I'm gonna go back, make some darks darker. There we go. Back of the leg. There's gonna be like a fold of skin here. If you ever look at like the foot of an ostrich or even a chicken, Okay, where the foot, this is the foot, by the way. Okay, a lot of people think dinosaurs, their knees bend backwards. Their knees don't bend backwards. They have all the same bones in their legs that we do. They just walk on their toes. So this is the thigh, this is the knee, this is the calf, this is the heel, which we walk on. They don't. This is the foot bones, which we walk on. This is where like the soles of our shoe go. And then these are the toes. They have longer toes than us. So we walk with our whole foot. They don't. They only walk on their toes. Your dog and cat or cat is like that too, by the way. Dogs and cats don't have backwards knees either. They most animals actually have legs more like that. Primates don't though, like humans, and bears don't either. There's a couple others. But most animals tend to walk on their toes, especially ones that do a lot of running or walking. All right. Gonna do some shading under the toes and the claws. Don't forget this little small claw, by the way. I didn't mention it. But there's three major toes that it walked on, one, two, three. But then there's a little small claw that it didn't walk on that was up here, by the way. And then I'm going to draw some scales. So these are scales that maybe you would be able to see on the toes. And modern birds have these exact same scales. A lot of modern birds have them. So chickens have them. Even little songbirds like sparrows and stuff have scales like this. Birds of prey have them, like owls and hawks and stuff. So ostriches have them. So dinosaurs may have had something like that too. So you can see I draw, it kind of looks like they have tire treads on their on the top of their feet. Okay. Let's see. Linda wants to know, does that mean T-Rex stood to sleep and couldn't walk backwards? No, it probably could lay down and sleep. Because if you think about it, like chickens, they sit on their feet and they kind of hunker down and they use this pubis bone here to as like a little boot. They could have lied down on their side too. I've seen chickens lie on their sides. And I used to be a zookeeper. I used to work at the zoo in New Jersey, the Van Son Park Zoo or Bergen County Zoo in Paramus. And they have these birds called rheas there, which are in the same family as ostriches. They're a little smaller. And I actually saw a rhea lay flat on its belly with its neck and its legs stretched out in all directions. So dinosaurs probably could lay down and stuff like that too. Yeah, so the belly is going to be here. I'm going to shade a little bit under there, a little bit of shading under on the shin here. Sometimes if you need help shading, what you do is you imagine if there is light, like a sun. You got think about where the sun is going to be coming from in your picture. So I imagine that the sun is going to be coming from up here. So this side of T-Rex's body is not going to have any light on it, but sorry, not going to have any shadow. And all my shadows are going to be kind of on the bottom part and maybe slightly towards the left of the page. I know some artists actually what they'll do to give them a better idea is they'll actually use models. And they'll take a model, and I have a light up there, and they'll just look at the model under a lamp at different angles, and they'll try to see what it looks like, and then they'll just do the shadow on their own drawing based on that. So you see how there's like a nice big shadow here and here. Okay, they would use this as a reference. Never be afraid to use your toys and things like that for references. If you don't have a toy of the dinosaur you want. I know some people will take Play-Doh or clay and they'll make shapes, not exactly, but they'll make shapes that kind of mimic what they want to draw to give them a better idea. Gonna draw some more scribbly lines here for the tail, implying some shading. And I'm drawing these curvy lines, and notice I'm making them curving, which gives the illusion that the tail is thick and round, almost tubular. Okay, so note how I did that here. Okay, it's kind of scribbly. Don't be afraid to make it scribbly. But that kind of implies that it's more three-dimensional. You'd be amazed at how much these little tiny lines can make something look like it's 3D. It's pretty crazy. But anyway, let's see. So I think our T-Rex is mostly done. I know I said in the beginning I was going to do a juvenile T-Rex. I think I took up the whole page. I don't know if I have room for it. Maybe if we have time at the end. But I would like to do some colors. Someone asked if we could do a Gorgosaurus. Maybe. Like I said, we only have enough time to do Tyrannosaurus Rex today, but going forward, maybe we can do a Gorgosaurus. That would be cool. But anyway, yeah. So let's do some color. So I have, let's see. I'm just gonna take a quick screenshot of this with my phone because that's pretty cool. This is fun. There we go. I have some paints with me. Now you don't have to use paint. You can use whatever you want. You could use crayons. You could use colored pencils. I have my own set of colored pencils here too that I use for other things. But I can use some watercolor paints. Maybe you have watercolor paints anyway. Watercolors aren't too hard to find, and they're pretty cheap at the store. You could buy like a little set of them. Here's my special Triceratops paintbrush holder. So these are all my watercolor paintbrushes. This is a big jug of water, clean, cold water, excuse me, that I'm gonna use to rinse off my brushes between coats. And here's my palette. And you can see I can hold this sideways because watercolor is a cool paint because it's actually good if it dries on the palette. It's better because it'll last longer. And you use the water to activate the colors. Okay. And this is something that you kind of got to practice. The other thing I need, which is underneath my desk here. Not very messy here. There we go. There's a rag. I have just like an old rag that I used to wipe off my paintbrushes. So I'm not going to go too crazy, but I'm going to give this guy or gal a little bit of color here. So great thing about most dinosaurs, not all, is that you can make them whatever color you want, whatever you think looks cool. I try to be logical with the colors that I choose. So even though like a bright pink and purple and lime green dinosaur sounds neat, real life it probably wasn't those colors, realistically speaking, because if you're a big predator, you want to blend in, right? And if you're bright pink, you're not going to blend in with the trees and the dirt. There's some dinosaurs that we actually do know the color of, believe it or not. I don't know if anybody knew that, but it's true. Some dinosaurs we actually know what colors they are. These dinosaurs died under certain circumstances where they were buried right away, and they were fossilized so well that even their skin or their feathers, in some of these cases, preserved as well. And what paleontologists figured out they can do is if they look at samples of the skin and the feathers, and they look it under a microscope, they can compare the little cells or the organelles in the cells, they call them, that preserved, and compare them to the of living animals, and they can match up the cells, the shape of the cells, the living ones, and figure out what color they were. So some dinosaurs with feathers, like Archaeopteryx that we know of, we're pretty sure that they had at least some black feathers. And then there's a dinosaur, a little dinosaur from Asia called Psittacosaurus or Psittacosaurus. It's a ceratopsian. It's related to Triceratops, which we know was like brown. It was like darker brown on top and lighter brown on the bottom. There's a dinosaur called Sinoceropteryx from Asia, which had like a gingery colored feathers on its back and like lighter color on the bottom and stripes in the tail. And you can even see like with the naked eye, the stripes in the tail. It's pretty cool. There's other ones too. Tyrannosaurus Rex, we don't know what color it was. So we can do whatever we want. I'm gonna do a brownish T-Rex, and I'm gonna give it like a little bit of pattern too. So to make brown, and the cool thing about watercolor is watercolor, you have to make your own colors most of the time. They give you some of the basic colors, but most of the time you have to make your own colors. So what I'm gonna do, if you guys can see this here, I'm gonna take to make brown, you take red. So I dip my paintbrush in some water, and then I'm very gently touching it to the red paint. And again, if you have colored pencils or crayons, you can use that too. But I'm just gonna show you how I'm doing this. And then you mix red with green. Red and green are opposite colors, so they make brown. Everyone thinks red and blue are opposite colors for some reason. They're not opposite colors. Red and blue get along quite nicely. They make purple. But if two colors are opposite, they will make brown when they're mixed together. So red and green are actually true opposites, and they make brown. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a little bit of orange here, and I'm going to mix a little bit of orange there to make it a little bit like sandier, a little bit brighter looking. And that's going to be like my basic color for this guy. All right, so now I'm going to start painting ever so gently, not too much, of the head. So I'm starting with the tip of the nose and doing the lip. I'm going over the eye. Here's the other. I'm not painting the actual eye itself. I'm not going over that. I'm going to keep that little circle in there white. And then let's see. I'm going to go over the top of the head here. And don't be afraid to be messy. It doesn't have to be perfect. Nature's not perfect either, right? A lot of animals in nature, they have designs on them and patterns which are not perfect. They're kind of squiggly looking. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a little water and just kind of blend that. So I'm actually not putting too much color on the bottom jaw just yet. Now I am though. So I'm taking some very light, and see how this is mostly water. There's very little paint in here. Okay. It's like very light. It's like almost like a tint. Okay. If you put too much paint on it, you're not going to see all the cool lines, the drawing that you worked so hard to make, right? So you don't want to put too much paint on there because then you're not going to see all the cool stuff you drew earlier. Gotta make a little bit more paint here. The paint will run out, so I gotta make more brown. Now, this new brown that I'm making, I'm gonna try to make it as close to the original brown as possible, but because I'm not a robot or a computer, it's not gonna be exactly the same. The proportions might be a little different of the different colors, the red, the green, and the orange, but that's okay because, like I said earlier, in real life, animals are different colors anyway. Oh, yeah, see, this brown is a little different shade. See? Came out different. That's okay though. It'll look cool. Moving on to the belly and the arm. Do-do-do. Cool thing about watercolor is it teaches you a lot about colors. It teaches you about mixing colors. A lot of things that you didn't maybe not already knew. So maybe some of you guys already know what colors make, like if you mix red with blue, like we said before, you get purple, or if you mix green, I'm sorry, if you mix blue with yellow, you get green, or red with yellow, you get orange. But then there's some other color combinations that maybe you didn't know that might come in handy when you're making a picture. So for instance, if you want to paint a shadow, and we're going to paint the shadow underneath this T-Rex in a bit, okay? You actually, a lot of people think, oh, I'm just going to use black. But the thing about black is, black will actually often, if you use just black by itself, especially with shadows, it'll make something look less three-dimensional, make it look more flat. And that's not necessarily a good thing. But what will work really well is if you take your black paint and mix it with a little bit of blue, or take your black crayon or colored pencil and use that on your picture, and then go back with blue and color a little bit of blue into your shadow as well on top of the black. And blue will actually make something pop a lot more and make it look much more realistic. Next time you go outside for maybe a walk in your backyard, because we can't go too far from our houses right now, especially there's a lot of people. But if you want to go outside for some fresh air, look at the shadows that are on like the trees and on the ground. Okay, you can see it looks more blue than anything else. Cool. So I did it like a base coat on my Tyrannosaurus in brown. That looks pretty good. Looks pretty cool. Definitely brown. And now I'm gonna go and I'm gonna do the inside of the mouth. Okay, so let's do the inside of the mouth. So again, we don't know what colors dinosaurs had on their skin or inside their mouth for the most part. If you look at modern animals, most of us have like a pink inside of our mouth, like our tongue. Pink. But some don't. Like some birds actually don't have, and I say birds a lot because birds are living dinosaurs themselves. They're always kind of like going to be the first go-to reference for a living animal when you're doing dinosaurs. So like some birds have like bright yellow on the inside of their mouth, like birds of paradise. Some other reptiles, like certain lizards, like the blue-tongued skink, it's in the name, it has a blue tongue. Some snakes have black tongues. So, T-Rex may not have had just a pink tongue. I am going to do the tongue in pink because I'm a boring person like that. No, I just think it looks cool. I think it'll be a nice contrast with the brown. But again, if you want to give your T-Rex like a blue tongue or whatever, that's fine with me. It's your painting. You do it the way you want to. There we go. A little bit of pink in there. Looking good. Yeah, that's nice. Much better. And then I'm going to go and I'm going to do the claws.
I'm going to use the same brown that I had before, the leftover paint. I'm going to mix with a little bit of black. That's not pure black. It's black mixed with brown. And I'm going to do the claws. I feel like I'm working at a nail salon, giving T-Rex a nice manicure here. Or no, pedicure. My bad. Pedicure is the toes. Manicure would be the fingers. So, doing the toes first. Do-do-do. There we go. Now we're doing the claws and the fingers. Now I'm doing the manicure. Cool. All right. Let's give our T-Rex some pattern. Let's not make it just solid brown. Now it could have been, right? Some animals are just solid one color, right? More or less. But it might have had some kind of like stripes or spots or something. That's cool. So let's do that now. I'm gonna use like a darker version of the brown. And I'm going to make some stripes and spots maybe. So I'm going to use a smaller brush for this. Let's see. This is like a slightly more narrow brush. Again, you can use whatever you want. I'm going to mix a little bit more brown here first. The red plus the green. A little bit more red. A little bit more green equals brown. Great. And then there's already some black in there from before. So this is the perfect color. And I'm gonna start with the eyes. And I'm gonna actually do some cool like stripey pattern over the eyes here. Now, a lot of animals have dark markings over their eyes. And they have that for different reasons. So some animals, like say like a raccoon or something, might have those to blend in, to camouflage. You all know like raccoons have that like little black mask. But I'm gonna, oops, sorry, it's not on the camera. There you go. Now you can see it. But some other animals have like a lot of other animals have black stripes over the eyes that you might not have realized. Like a cheetah. Everyone knows cheetahs have stripes. Did you know they have black markings over their eyes as well? They do. If you look at a picture of a cheetah in one of your books, or next time you get to go to the zoo, you'll see they have black stripes over the eyes. And that's to help keep the sun out of their eyes. So black as a shade will absorb light. That's why if it's the summertime, you don't want to wear too many dark colors on, like on a shirt, because you'll get hot more quickly. Okay. So it's also why like baseball players and football players, American football players, I guess, they typically put like black paint on their faces because when they're out there during a game out on the field, they don't want the sun to get in their eyes. The sun will get absorbed by the black and it will keep the glare out of their eyes. And animals will have that for the same reason. So if Tyrannosaurus Rex was living out on like a big floodplain, okay, big swamp, and it's big, right? It's not like it could hide in the shade of trees as easily, right? I'm sure there were some big trees back then, but not as many. If you're a T-Rex, if you're like 42 feet long and 15 feet tall, you might be in the sun more often than not. So having some black markings over the eyes might help. Again, I'm not saying it definitely had these. I'm just putting them on mine, and that's the reasoning for it. Maybe it didn't happen. We don't know. Not every animal that lives in that environment has the same adaptation. Nature's not perfect. Animals don't evolve perfectly, right? If evolution was perfect, nothing would ever evolve at all. So not every animal is perfectly adapted. In fact, most of them are not perfectly adapted. In fact, I can't think of anything that's perfectly adapted. Otherwise, like I said, evolution wouldn't happen in the first place. They wouldn't change. And do a little bit of striping on the feet. I like stripes on the feet. Honestly, want a little secret? People that are watching this, you're the only ones I've ever told. I put stripes on my dinosaur's feet like I'm doing right now. And the reason why I do it is because when I was a kid, little kid, I used to watch Land Before Time, the cartoon. Maybe some of you guys have seen that cartoon. It was a movie. They made a bunch of movies out of it. And a lot of the dinosaurs, I think specifically the Struthiomimus characters, had stripes on their feet. I just thought it was really neat. And I still do that sometimes with some of my dinosaurs based on that. I just think it's neat. All right, cool. So there's our T-Rex. So I'll show you what the stripes look like on this guy. Looks pretty neat. Some stripes on the face. They get lighter on the body. And there's some stripes on the feet. That's cool. All right. Now I'm going to go into the eye. And I'm actually going to use black here pure black. And that's okay if it's just a little tiny bit, just to darken up the eye, just to make it more visible, make it stand out more. There. There we go. And I kept the middle of the eye like a little white dot of the paper. Because in real life, the eye shine, okay, any animal that's on land, like if you're looking at my eyes right now, like my eyes are brown with a black pupil, but you can still see like what looks like a little white fleck from the light, okay? So any animal that's out on land in the sun, that would be there. So I'm keeping that there. Let's see. We have a little bit of time left, not too much, because I was supposed to start at 4. We start a little late, so we have like maybe 5 minutes left. So I'm going to give it a very rough background. I'm not going to go crazy in the background. If you guys want to continue your drawing after the live stream and make the background more complete, you can. But I'm just going to do a very, very light, rough, messy background. And that's okay. I have some paintings that I've done that have like a full detailed background where every single leaf is filled in, and that's cool. But then I have some paintings where it's not a full background. It's very messy, kind of like I'm doing here. And that's not necessarily a bad thing all the time. It kind of accentuates the dinosaur itself, and that's cool too. So I'm just going to paint some brown around the feet. I'm not worried about getting into every single little nook and cranny. It's all right. I'm not going crazy with this. And it's okay if it's not completely solid, because the ground's not completely solid either, right? The ground's bumpy. Ground has little hills and divots in it. And, maybe the light's reflecting off of parts of the ground or something, or there's different shadows. So it's okay if the ground's not completely flat or perfectly. In fact, honestly, if the ground was completely perfect looking, that would be weird and it wouldn't look right, honestly. Wouldn't look like a real scene in nature. So it's actually good if your ground is kind of messy looking. And now I'm going to take green, and I'm going to just quickly do some imply that there's maybe some like bushes or trees back there. And I'm just kind of just making squiggles. I'm just scribbling with wet green paint here. Okay? That's all I'm doing. It's easy, it's fun, and it looks great. It's awesome. See? Look. Look how messy that is, but it's beautiful. And see how the paint is dripping to the bottom? That's cool too. Looks like a natural, imperfections in nature. It could look like shadow. It could look like maybe a darker leaf, because leaves aren't all the same color. Next time you go outside, look at a tree or a bush and look at all the leaves in that thing. And you'll know that not all the leaves are exactly the same color. Some are older, some are younger. They change colors. All right, cool. And now, lastly, I'm going to do the shadow. So the shadow, I'm going to mix, like I said before, black with blue. So there's the black paint here. And I'm going to get some blue paint to mix with the black paint. It's going to be like a very dark blue. So it's going to start under the feet. And remember, we said how wide T-Rex's body was. So the body is really wide. So I'm going to make sure the shadow reflects that. I don't want my shadow to just take a little line. It's going to be a pretty wide shadow because T-Rex is a wide dinosaur. Big dinosaurs make big shadows, right? And then the tail, note how the tail curves up. Okay. So the tail, tail is going to be curving away. Okay. So my shadow is going to reflect that. My shadow is also going to curve away like a hook. So I did that. The shadow curves away like a little hook, and that makes it show that the tail is also curved away. Nice. Now, our last finishing touches, and again, you don't have to do this. If you like the way your drawing looks by itself, that's cool. But I don't know about you, but like after I put the paint on, it kind of almost looks a little flat. Not as bright as it could be with this style. So if I was doing like a long-term painting, I would go back and I'll put layers upon layers upon layers of. Oh, Sophia says her favorite is Triceratops. Mine too, Sophia. You have good taste. The best dinosaur. You picked the best dinosaur for your favorite. Good job. Maybe we'll do Triceratops next time. So far, some people have requested Baryonyx. and Parasaurolophus and Triceratops I've seen. So maybe we'll do one of those guys. Anyway, so I'm gonna kind of go over it with ink, a black pen. Okay, if this was a painting that I had a lot more time to do and resources to do, I would actually go over it with many, many, many layers of this watercolor until it looks the way I want it to look. But if you do it with a little black pen, it'll look like a different style. It's not going to be better or worse. It's just going to look like a different kind of piece of art, which is great, which is fine. All right, so I'm going to start with the head because this is what I painted first, so I know this paint is dry. This paint down here is still wet, so I'm not going to go over that with black ink. And I'm just going to very quickly, and I don't have to do everything in black ink. I'm not going over every single line that I did. I'm just doing the basic lines. And I'm not shading with the black ink. I left the shading to the pencil, okay, and the paint a little bit. Especially the part where it's fuzzier, I'm not going through over the whole thing. I'm just drawing a couple lines there, and I'm moving on. I'm going to accentuate that cracked, scaly, dry texture that would have been on the mouth. Get some wrinkles around the nostrils, implying that the nostrils could probably open and close. That's pretty cool to think about. I don't know if it actually could do that. I don't know if anybody knows that. You know how like a dog or a cat can kind of open and close their nostrils a little bit when they sniff? Or maybe it was more like an alligator. Not actually, no, alligators can open and close their nostrils. Maybe it was more like a lizard where they kind of had nostrils that were just kind of stuck in place. Or a bird. A lot of birds have that too. And now I'm doing the teeth. Now I'm noticing that when I painted the pink inside the mouth, some of the pink did bleed onto my bottom teeth. So now T-Rex has like my T-Rex has like some teeth on the bottom jaw that are pink. But that's okay. That's fine. It looks fine to me. I don't think it's ruined at all. In fact, you could even say that, oh, maybe the T-Rex was eating some meat, like a dead dinosaur, and got some blood on its teeth, and the blood's dried off and come off a bit, and it came out looking all pink now. So you can kind of make up a little story to go with the way your painting came out. All right, so I'll show you how that looks so far with the black outline. Looks much nicer, much more bold. You can see all the detail now. All right, I'm gonna keep going with this. Moving on to the arm. There's one claw. There's two claws. Here's the neck. Here's the belly. Here's the knee, leg, ankle, little short inner claw. The foot, toes. More toes. Okay. Kneecap. All right. Again, don't forget, if you take a picture or scan your drawing that you did today with me and put it, I think, in the comments section, then you might win some tickets to Field Station Dinosaurs. And I will be at Field Station Dinosaurs drawing some dinosaurs in person on July 11th. So maybe I'll see you then. All right, now I'm working on the tail. I'm almost done. There we go. Whoopsie. See, I just messed up. I completely just messed up. I drew a black line where I didn't mean to draw a black line. See? Right there. But that's okay. It's not ruined. It still looks fine to me. Sometimes making art is a lot of times just making mistakes and just dealing with it. And there we go. All right. So I think our T-Rex is done. And last thing we're gonna do, everyone has to do this, is you gotta write your name. If you did a your own drawing, make sure you sign your name on the bottom of it. Okay. So I'm gonna just write my name. I just write my first name, Chris, and then the first initial of my last name, D. I don't write my whole last name.
That's what I do. There it is. Boop. Most artists, just so you know, typically you write your name on the bottom right corner of the piece. But I know some artists that don't do that, but most artists do that. And there you have it. There we go. Looking good. All right. So I hope that everybody here shares their own T-Rex that they did today with me. And again, remember, yours doesn't have to look the same as mine. Yours can be a little different. That's fine too. And I'll talk with the folks from Field Station, and maybe we'll do it again. Maybe we'll do it next week or something. Maybe we'll do one of the dinosaurs that people requested. So yeah, and one more time, make sure you send in the drawing and put it in the comments below, and then you'll be entered in to win a pack. I believe it's four tickets. So for like a family four pack of tickets. Yep. So until next time, keep drawing.